thanks everyone for coming at short notice to this meeting. It's not my fault that we're here, but we're here anyway. Could I just remind people to speak up? We have the microphones, also turn mobile phones off, or put them onto silent. And have you got any apologies for absence?
Ian Lewis and Tracy Pilgrim and both Cathy Hodson deputising.
I'm not going to lose size Steve Bag. Steve Bag's not deputising.
Okay, I'll invite members to declare an interest and confirm there's no party work. Meeting requisition. This committee meeting following a requisition by five members of the committee for a special meeting to discuss the recent letter from the Secretary of State for Communities and Local Government. The details of the requisition are included in your papers. I'm now going to invite David Ball, Assistant Director for Environmental Services, to speak to us, please.
Okay.
And introduce your report.
Thank you very much. What we've done for you in terms of the report is set out the letter that the Council's received from the Secretary of State. And in addition to that, we have put the current timeline for the delivery of the local plan. And that's on page 9 of the document there. Would I just take you through the letter?
Yes, please.
Yep, okay. The leader of the council received this letter on the 16th of November of this year. The Secretary of State was writing about the local plan intervention, and the main grounds for that appear to be the government's drive to ensure that more homes are built and housing needs are met. The letter sets out that the council has to respond to the Secretary of State by the end of January with an explanation of where we currently are with our local plan and the timescales for its future delivery. The letter is not totally clear in terms of the arrangements for intervention and on what grounds that would be done. So the leader of the council has asked me to speak to civil servants in the Department of Communities and Local Government and seek further clarification on that point, and I'll be doing that over the next few days. The leader has advised that he wants to be in a position to respond to the Secretary of State by the middle of January, and so that would comply with the deadline of the end of that month. If I could just make a couple of observations in addition to that on the letter, just for members' benefit. The first of those is that we do have a local development scheme for Whittle. That is in place. It consists of two parts. One is a published local development scheme, and the second is what we call a real-time update, which was requested by government some time ago. So prior to the Secretary of State writing the letter to the council, there was information available on our website that gave our current timetable and also gave a series of real-time information updates. And I'm not quite sure the reasons for this, but those real-time updates don't seem to have been taken into account prior to this letter being written from what we can assess. The second observation to make is that there is a suggestion in the letter that not having an up-to-date local plan has a number of implications. One of those is around the extent to which authorities are working cooperatively in preparing strategic plans. In terms of Wirral and the Liverpool City region, that's not an issue for us because we are working strategically on plans. So the joint waste local plan for Merseyside and Halton that members may recall was agreed back in 2013 is an example of that work that we continue to do. In addition to that, there's the statement of cooperation, which members may recall was approved in 2016. At Liverpool City Region level, the SHELMA, which is the Strategic Housing Employment Land Assessment work, has been published and is being done cooperatively. And we've complied with all of the development requirements in the devolution agreement for the Liverpool City Region in terms of moving forward with the spatial plan for that area. There's also a comment in here about potential impact of the plan having on neighbourhood planning activity. Again, Wirral already has two neighbourhood planning areas. Those are Devonshire Park and Hoylake, and we have a further three in the pipeline. So those neighbourhood plans continue to come through, and there's no issue with those. So I think those were the observations I just wanted to make on the letter for members. Clearly, once I sought further clarification from the civil servants, I will have a clearer view from them in terms of the actual grounds and reasons why the Secretary of State may be seeking to intervene here. And then obviously I'm happy to update members as this matter progresses prior to the Leader of the Council writing a formal response to the Secretary of State in the middle of January next year. One final thing, if I may, because I have been asked this question. Just in terms of the local plan framework and what do we have in place at the moment to make decisions? Well, we have two things really. One is the Unitary Development Plan 2000. The Secretary of State saved those policies in 2007. And we have that in place alongside the National Planning Policy Framework. Now, our current local plan, the Unity Development Plan, and our emerging local plan, there's a great deal of similarity between those two plans, and many of the policies would be the same, there would be some difference. But in terms of currently considering planning applications, that is the policy framework that we would use, and it's an effective framework. So I've been asked in other forums about well, what impact does this have, for example, on developments that may come forward in the Greenbelt. And there we have our Greenbelt policies in place locally alongside the government's policies on Greenbelt. And if you look back in terms of planning appeals on greenfield sites in the Greenbelt, where the council has refused those, we've won every one of those on appeal. So our current arrangements, whilst not being up to date, they are in a place where we can actually manage the planning and we can make appropriate decisions and we can defend those decisions on appeal. So I think I'll stop there from an introduction point of view. Sorry, Jeff, I missed some of that, but
I'm sure it was high quality stuff to the
I tried my best in terms of that, and those are my comments in terms of the report.
Okay. Sorry, Jeff, can you deputise him?
Yeah.
It was a Tracy. A Tracy. Okay. Right, I'm going to open it now to members' questions. Adam, Chris, Andrew, and Brian.
Thanks, Chair. Obviously, David, we brought it to you because the Secretary of State intervening on anything needs to be taken seriously, and members need to be up to date as to what the council is actually doing.
Yeah.
Now, to put it into context, we're only one of 13 councils across the country that's in this position. So, I know you didn't go into it in this day, but why are we so behind as compared to other councils? And is the fact that we're going to say it's going to be ready in 3 years' time, is that going to be good enough? Is it, you know, or isn't there anything that can be done to move that schedule forward?
So to take your last question first, the timetable that we've set out on page 9, given that it's in a regulatory statutory framework, we believe is the shortest possible time that you can actually do all those steps to reach that end point.
Whatever the council do it quickly.
Yes. So, coming back then to your first question, why are we behind? The reason for that is slightly complicated. I'll try and explain it. John Entwistle, and my colleague here from Forward Planning, will help to contribute to that. But in terms of preparing the local plan for Wirral, clearly there are a number of key issues with regards to our planning process. The first of those is around meeting the housing needs, which we've spoken about probably many times before. And related to that then is the land allocation, where you're actually going to build those houses. Now, our current analysis of the situation is that we don't have enough housing land to meet the housing need requirements. So the administration decided to do a number of pieces of work around housing need, and that was out there to establish clearly what the numbers are that we need to build and what the needs are. So those needs assessments have been done over a period of time. Related to that then, there was work that came in from the city region that led to that having to be modified, reviewed and looked at. And you're probably aware that just recently the government has consulted on the methodology for calculating housing need again, and it's given a figure for each of the local authorities in the country. Wirral's is 803 new units per annum. But the outcome of that consultation is not yet known, and the methodology and the calculation. So there's all of those things that are moving. And alongside that then, there is the issue of how you look at your future development options. So where are you going to build these houses? And the administration decided that what it would do on that is to consult in two parts, really. This could have been done in one go, but a decision was taken to do it in two parts. So there's been a green belt review methodology, in other words, how you would do that review. That consultation has just closed today, yesterday, 6th of December, around that. And that was asking people, how should we do it? Did we have to do it? And all of that information, plus other things that we're bringing in from some of the city region, Shelner studies and so on, which we're waiting for the reports to come back from the combined authority, will all come together in a report next June or July, which will establish the housing numbers, which will look at your land allocations. And the critical thing is, until you've determined those things and you've actually got 15-year supply broken down into 5-year supplies, if you don't have that information, if we were to put the plan in, it would be put back to us as being unsound, because it's clearly got to have all that information in there. So that is part of the reason why this has taken quite a long time to do, and those were the processes that were involved in that, if that helps. Now, again, if you want to go back to 2004 when the Act came in, I wasn't responsible at that time, but in very brief outline, and John can probably cover more detail around this. In 2004, the Act came in. I understand at that time the Council decided to look at revising its unity development plan as the method of doing its new plan. And then in 2007, there were some changes, which meant that we couldn't continue down that course of action. And what had to start from there was effectively one of the new development plans. And that then has been moving forward over that period of time, you know, and again, there's more things that we can talk about as to go over that years with changes. to various regulation information that's come in and decisions taken by the administration and so on. And that's where we find ourselves today.
So just to clarify, as compared to other councils, surely all other councils face those same regulations coming in at the same time. So to take our neighbours in the city region, as you say, the certain reports, are our neighbours in the city region, have they got plans in place then? Or are all of those areas waiting on these reports as well?
No, a number of those areas have already got their local plans in place. The reason why we are where we are is because of the decisions that have been taken politically in terms of how to do each step of the process that has gone on.
Okay. Thank you.
I've got Chris, Andrew, Brian, Christina, and Jeff.
Thanks, Chair. I think you've answered some of my questions. Thank you, David. So I'm going to rephrase it.
Okay.
I was looking at the last core strategy time, David, and this plan was due to be completed in December 2017.
Yes.
Yeah. So my question now is, how long does it take to write one of these plans? Because obviously things move constantly. And since it was since 2004, we still haven't got a plan.
Yes.
What makes us think we're going to get a plan in the next 6 months if we haven't been able to do one in the last however many years?
In response to that, a general observation first of all that plan making in this country is very slow as a process. But in terms of the difference between the last local development scheme and the one you just referred to, there are issues there with information around housing needs assessment, which was delayed. And because of that, that slowed down the process of developing the plan. And then the second element to that are that clearly there are a number of political decisions taken by the administration which also influence the timing and production of the plan. I can only comment as an officer on the facts of the situation, and obviously we work under instruction in terms of those matters.
Can I just have a quick question? In your estimation, David, how long would it take to do one of these plans? How long should it take to write one of these plans? Average, because as Councillor Sykes said, we only want 17 that can't produce 30.
Yeah, it's a difficult question to answer, but if there's a process set out, you know, a series of regulations, so you know what you need to go through. If you get all of that information and those studies there and in place at the right time, we've actually written the bulk of the plan. That's already there, and it's been to members before, back in 2012, wasn't it, and so on. And you can see that, that's a document that we have. It is now, as I said, coming down to these critical issues around the housing needs and the housing allocations, and then that's where it becomes a matter where we can do all the technical studies, all of those are done, located, all that information is there, and then it's if you like a political decision in terms of managing that and how that is done.
Andrew?
Thank you. David, am I right when you started off by saying you didn't understand why the tone of the letters the way it was, when it's accusing us of not doing what we're supposed to have done? And if that's the case, with regards to the development plan, with the real time, are we sending enough information through to central government? And the last one is, the last paragraph is, my officials have been engaging your officers to discuss the progression of your plan, more likely. Well, within those discussions where they're engaging with us, have we not asked them what's the problem, why we're getting a letter so such a stage yet? Are the discussions going on with central government at the point?
Yes, so what we've been doing, Andrew, on a regular basis is talking to CLG all the way through the plan making process. So they would know where we are actually up to at any one point in time, because we've got that real-time information. Just in terms of the Secretary of State's letter, the letter is clear in certain respects, but it's not really clear on the grounds of intervention and what he's actually looking for there. And that is the issue that we are now seeking to clarify with DCLG civil servants. Now, the email from them only came through to us yesterday in terms of that, so I haven't had a chance yet to speak to the civil servant, but we will be doing that over the next few days to clarify those things. We'll also be having a discussion with them on a number of the observations that I've given to members this afternoon around the letter and the fact that, you know, we have made progress on a number of things, but that doesn't seem to be recognised in the letter. So, you know, we need to explore that a bit further. And what we don't want to do here is in any way get into, hopefully, any type of confrontational situations with the government or anybody else for that matter. And so we are going to try and work forward from where we are with the timeline that's attached in this report, and to say that you know, those are the timescales that we will work to, we will agree, and we can meet as a council. And you know, if the Secretary of State accepts that position, probably what he will require of the council is that those deadlines absolutely have to be met, or else other consequences will follow. And if that was to be the final position and outcome, then, you know, from an officer point of view, if you're asking me just to comment on the process and can I get through everything by that date, the answer is yes. But I would have to say that clearly, alongside that, there is a political process that the plan has to go through, you know, with various committees and council and so on. And that's an area, obviously, that I don't have control of in terms of that from there.
My concern is that, obviously, you've got accurate some of the things that have been said. I don't know why this has been having discussions with central governments.
Well,
he's only going up to been told by the people that carried out the survey, haven't
he? Yes, well, one of the questions we will want to ask of the civil servants is why, when we've been having regular dialogue with them, and we've also got real-time information on our progress on our website, which they have access to, why that wasn't, in our view, considered by the Secretary of State before the letter was written. Because they actually had that information through our conversations and through accessing our systems, and they knew about it. This letter came out the week before the Chancellor's statement, which followed the week after. And obviously housing was a key part of that. That's just an observation in there. But, you know, we just need to understand why they've written in the terms that they have.
That question's going to be asked.
Sorry?
That question's going to be asked why they haven't taken note of what we've actually said.
Absolutely it is, yes. Because, I mean, we're not trying to hide it here. We've been open, it's all on the website, it's there, everybody can see our current position. And what I would have expected is, if the Secretary of State was minded to write, that he wrote in a way that actually acknowledged all of that information, you know, in that process, rather than just saying, with respect to him, what he has done, which is not the fully informed position which we believe his officials were and are aware of.
I'll bring in Brian in a moment, and then Dr. Christine Ranger. I've just got a couple of questions, David.
Mm-hmm.
One is, are you aware whether this letter has been sent to other authorities that haven't the Catholic State with their plan? And the other one is, what is the implication of the Secretary of State intervening? Because the local authority haven't acted.
We understand that the same letter went to the other, it was another 14 authorities that were named. in the Secretary of State's statement. So we believe they've all got the same letter. In terms of answering the question about what are the implications of intervention, I can't really comment on those at the moment because the Secretary of State, as I understand it, has fairly wide powers of intervention. What he's not set out in the letter is what he's actually thinking by way of intervention and what does it mean. And it potentially could range from something on the one hand where he accepts our arguments and our local development scheme update, which is page 9 in the report, and says, right, I understand, that's your timeline, you can't do anything any quicker than that, but those deadlines are absolute drop-dead deadlines and you can't move from those and you have to produce your plan within that time frame at one end. Or at the other end, it could go through to him, I suppose, sending in civil servants or other officials to actually do that plan for Wirral and make us do that, if you like, more quickly. So there's a whole range there of potential interventions, but until I've spoken to the civil servants and actually understood really, you know, what has really motivated this, what's behind it, and what they're seeking to do and achieve out of it, I can't comment, unfortunately, in terms of the interventions, because I just need that information. But I'm quite happy, you know, obviously, to keep things up to date with this once I have that additional information.
Okay, so just to be clear, though, what you're saying is that as members, we can have input into the development of this plan, but if intervention is going to be imposed on us, that's not screening.
Well, if they go that far and they bring people in to do the plan, I suppose, yes, the Secretary of State can just take that responsibility to himself and do that. Yeah, that's the most extreme position there.
Right.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I'm also a little bit puzzled, to be honest, at the tone of the letter, which seems to be hinted about, you know, decisions on intervention and asking questions where I would have thought if we are having discussions, we would know the answer. And if, as David has confirmed, all the information is on the Wirral website anyway, then surely the information is available to them. But I've got two specific questions here. On the beginning of the fourth paragraph in the letter, it says local planning authorities are required to publish a local development scheme. Am I not right in thinking that we did that in 2015? So that's my first question. And the other one, I think you said before, David, that we've already got two neighbourhood plans within the borough, and there's three more in the pipeline. Well, am I not right in thinking that we've got neighbourhood plans set up for the Beechwood and Ballantyne area, and also for North Birkenhead? Well, if you can just clarify what plans we have got for you.
Okay. In terms of the local development scheme, yes, we've got one, and we've had one since 2015, which is now being updated, which is on page 9 in your paper, and that will be published formally in a couple of weeks' time with our annual monitoring report that we have to do each year. If you recall, we published that in December. In terms of the neighbourhood plans, we have approved neighbourhood plans for Devonshire Park and Hoy Lake. And the three in the pipeline, John might be able to help me with.
We've got Birkenhead and Tranmere,
yes.
North Birkenhead, Leeso is the other one, but I think there's also, as you say, the Beechwood area is potentially being designated. So there's a number of areas that have been designated.
Okay. Thank you, Jim.
Yeah, just querying the letter, David, and in a sense, this is totally non-political, isn't it? Because we're going back to 2004, so in between all this, every party in this room has been in power. And also, we've had change of leadership and change of party in Wirral. So why would he say that we failed to meet the deadline as set out in the timetable? And why, if we had a proposed submission draft in December 2012, that's 5 years ago, because I can remember us doing something on that, but I've never seen it again. And my other question is, the letter was sent on the 16th of November. Who's been in contact with them in that nearly a month to get those queries answered that you've raised? Is that been done by the chief exec or by Phil or somebody else? Because 3 weeks have gone by and we couldn't have the answer to it tonight, really.
And answer those questions. In terms of the plan that we had in 2012, that was there. As I understand it, and John might be able to provide more detail here, the key reason why things have been delayed there is in and around information to do with the housing needs assessment, on all of those types of things around development options for the land and other things. members making the decision at the time, wanting to understand those things, there was quite a bit of detailed work to do, and then the decision to consult on things like methodologies before actually consulting on the actual reviews of various pieces of land and other things.
So that's taken 5 years, is that where the 5 years
comes in? That has taken a period of time.
And that's been continuous, has it?
Well, that's been an ongoing situation, yes. So we've been looking at the housing needs and so on.
Well, we could say anything's an ongoing situation, couldn't we? Has it been live for 5 years, is what I'd like to know.
Yes, it's been live for 5 years.
It's been constantly worked on for 5 years.
It's been constantly worked on for 5 years. And we can do, and do the technical assessments and all of those technical reports. And we bring then those things through, and then there are decisions taken by the administration around the process and the timescales and the other things from there. In terms of the contact with the CLG, when the letter came in, obviously I was asked to go and see the leader of the council, first of all to have a discussion, you know, in terms of what he wanted us to do next. And then the CLG have recently appointed one of the civil servants to be the main contact with us at a more senior level than the day-to-day contacts that we normally deal with. Unfortunately, when they sent that email through to the chief executive of the council, they put the wrong email address on it, and it didn't reach us until yesterday. So I wasn't able to make contact with the person. I haven't had time today because I've unfortunately been tied up with other things. So now we've got the contact details and the information, we will be making early contact with them to clarify the position.
So you didn't chase up the fact we haven't heard from you?
Well, no, because the letter that was sent by the Secretary of State gave a specific period of time to respond. And so we will be using that time to respond to that letter. So we've done some of the background work, which I've explained and set out this afternoon. And then, as I said, the discussion took place with the leader of the council. He's asked us to clarify that with civil servants. So, you know, that's the process that we've been going through on this. And given that we have to respond by the end of January, you know, and the leader's view was we would respond in the middle of January when we've got all the information to hand. That's just part of the process we've been going through, really.
Could I ask the other part I asked about was, because your council has failed to meet the deadline set out in this timetable.
Yes.
Do we have the time? I know we've got this thing here that you've given us on tonight. So do we have the timetable and the bits where we failed to meet them?
Yes, in terms of that factual point, the Secretary of State is right, that we've had previous timetables for completion of the plan, and those dates have not been met for a variety of reasons.
How many can we have, please?
previous time tables.
Number, forget the precise number of local member schemes.
That's important. We failed to answer something. We can't remember how many times.
No, but what we've had a timetable for the plan from the beginning, but that timetable has been revised on a number of occasions due to various factors, some of which are technical, some of which are political. And, you know, if members want to see those, we can find them. I'm sure we'll have back copies of those. The key...
I would like to see which ones we've missed and what we've missed by. I think if we're to know exactly what's happened, which I think is part of our scrutiny role, we really need to have all the information. And whilst this course strategy timetable is useful, it's actually not set against anything, is it? So I'd like to see it set against what we were supposed to be doing. If that's that what you're agreeing with that?
Can I just add to that?
I've got
office
coming in, so I'll
add
So, Chair, through you, is that okay if we have that? We have the timetable and we have the departmental responsibility course kind of thing against
it.
That would be lovely. Thank you very much. So we'll know more about it.
Thank you. And I've got Jeff Crane and then Cathy.
Thanks. If I shall I start by saying apologising for being a little late. The most way was a bit difficult with the weather coming in. So apologies for that. And again, if I say something that David could have a little bit earlier, but I would say it strikes me, Chair, that what David was saying, maybe. Is that the officers could have got the report that we've had 30 years to do since here, 2004. In that sense, it is non-political because it would have been a previous, it would have been Tony Blair's government that said we needed to do it. So the officers could have done it, and more recently they could have got on with it, but it was political interventions and the administration. Ask, you know, pulling in things that prevented that. And it strikes me, when you actually then look at the risks, again, that in response to your question, Chair, about the range of interventions that could now flow from this deprioritisation, is a bit worrying. And again, I do hope someone will take the opportunity to upbraid the administration for playing so fast and loose with our planning framework. The other thing, it strikes me, I wonder if David could comment, is just trying to put all this together. I can remember when it first came out, we were told that one person would be put onto this, and it would all end up being cost neutral. But it strikes me as though, I seem to recall another letter that was sent by Phil and the Chief Executive indeed, to the Secretary of State, previous Secretary of State, explain the budget strategy that the authority had and why it wanted a 4-year settlement was about, well, the key element to that was building additional houses to increase the council tax base. I think that's correct, isn't it, David? And then the number of houses that was developed from our own report, not government report, but our own report, housing needs assessment, said that we wanted to build something like 800 odd houses a year, which was way beyond, it came out at about 800 houses a year, but way beyond anything we've done before, and meant that we would run out of brownfield sites and would need to go into the Greenbelt. And from what I could tell, the administration and the officers were developing their plan to announce that they were going to have to build on the Green Belt, and you know, we should argue about whether there were any golf courses were going to be used around that. But then all of a sudden, the brakes were thrown on, yeah, and the leader of the council had announced in the paper, as I recall, that you know, he'd die in the ditch to save the Green Belt. Mm. And so it strikes me as though the administration did this massive pirouette from what it had said was its budget strategy to then making a series of different announcements when they decided not to sell Bracknell Golf Course and all the rest of it. I think probably what's generated this letter is this frustration from officers can do it because it's a technical piece of work, but this constant political, you know, yes we'll do it, no we won't, yes we'll do it, no we won't, this lack of cohesion and leadership from the administration. I wonder whether that letter has been borne out by that frustration. If we constantly set out plans and then constantly fail to achieve them, then, you know, I presume the Secretary of State, who's carrying out the, you know, the 2004 Act, is probably looking at this and saying, well, what's changed? Because the definition of madness, isn't it, is keep doing the same thing and expecting a different result. So I do hope that this committee will take the opportunity to raise this issue with the Leader of the Council and say that actually by this ongoing interference in the work of the officers in terms of coming up with an objective result has led directly to this intervention and the risks that David mentioned in response to you, Paul. So I do hope the committee will take that opportunity because, you know, it strikes me this mucking about is putting our green belt and our how we want to develop rural at risk, because it could well be that the Secretary of State has to intervene centrally. And, you know, I find it really odd that no one in the cabinet or the administration have actually gripped this issue, followed it through, made some decisions and tracked whether it was on progress or not, in progress or not. But just can I just be clear with David again? David said that technically officers would have been able to deliver this local plan prior to this letter, but it was a series of political decisions administered by the administration that have held up that process.
In terms of the technical processes officers could do this, the plan making function is obviously it's a council plan, and so clearly has a political element to it because it has to go through the processes of the councillors and the committees and to make the appropriate decisions on those matters. And as I say, as an officer of the council, I can manage the technical side of things and I work under instructions from whatever the administration is at a particular moment in time. I can account and will account for officer matters, but clearly I can't comment, I'm afraid, on political matters. Those obviously have to be handled by the administration.
Thank you. I have to say
first of all,
I agree with
everything
that Jeff said.
That's always a good start,
Kevin. it's not, I don't suppose, coincidental that the Act passed in 2004 coincided with enlargement when another 15 countries joined the EU, obviously in terms of their administration, where lack of transitional border controls were not put up. There was a lack of transitional border control, they weren't put up. So I'm assuming the Act came into force because it was seen that in the forthcoming years there'd be a lot of people coming into the country who need housing. Has the revised timetable been agreed to the Central Office on an ongoing basis? And how often does central government chase it with authorities that are behind them? On the basis that we haven't done it in 13 years.